So these are all, now we're in the early Jurassic period, and our star of the show, yeah, is Cryolophosaurus. We know the most about this animal. And so we've got his skeleton around in these cases, including the skull here. And also, what we pulled out here, this is a second brain case. So only recently, as we kept preparing this material, we started finding duplicates of some elements. And so we realized we've got at least two specimens of this meat eater in the same quarry.
Wow. This is his skull, right?
Yeah, and the first thing you're going to notice, right, is that he's missing the toothy bits.
Right. Okay, now I see it. I was a little lost there for a second.
So that front of the skull was actually weathering out the side of the cliff face, actually just below that femur.
Wow.
Right, so the femur was sticking out the side, and there was, in cross-section, parts of the jaw sticking out. We actually found a couple of chunks of jaw down the hill that had weathered out, that match up with it.
So is his brain cavity then in the back over here?
Yeah, you can kind of see through. There's the orbit is that kind of keyhole shaped,
right.
And then behind it there's another fenestra or opening, and then kind of inside that opening you can see some more bones that are kind of the lateral wall of the brain case. And there's even if you look closely, a few kind of little openings or holes where the cranial nerves are popping out.
How big was his brain?
Well, that's a great question. We actually CT scanned this specimen and then worked up that data so that you can manipulate the scan of the skull. We actually can render out
the brain
here.
Oh my gosh.
So, you know, not as large as kind of a modern bird brain, but larger relatively than kind of a reptilian brain. And starting to kind of modify a few things in the structure of these different regions. And we've even got...
Now, in terms of shape, is it like a bird?
It's more similar to a bird, but we've actually started kind of, if you kind of view the alligator as kind of a more kind of starting position, we've kind of shifted these two parts of the brain from kind of being more in a straight line to this part is starting to come over the hindbrain a little bit and enlarge. This little flexure here is common to these early meat-eating theropods. We have that in a lot of them. And then, yeah, we have some little stalks from the cranial nerves. And then we don't have it on this model, but you can see in the scan, we've actually got the semicircular canals there.
Oh, wow. That is amazing.
Yeah, so all kinds of cool information we can get about the biology of these animals now using this new technology.
It's phenomenal. You know, I mean, the bird brain is actually a misnomer.
That's right.
Birds are amazingly smart.
Incredibly smart.
You know, so who knows? These guys could have been pretty wily themselves. They probably were great hunters.
Absolutely. And we've got most of the skeleton.
Oh.
Yeah. So there's a couple parts of the tail and hip, the very kind of ends of the feet, the hand, we don't have that, the tips of the lower jaw, but most of the rest of the skeleton, we've got material for it. So we've got a pretty good idea of what this animal looked like.
And he's a big boy.
Yeah, he was probably the largest predator running around during the early Jurassic. So this is obviously one of the highlights of the whole exhibit, is that we've actually got the full reconstruction of Cryolophosaurus here.
And expedition, for that matter. This is like an expedition.
The highlight of several expeditions that it took to get these bones down here.
Oh my gosh, that is just stunning.
Yeah, it is beautiful, and it really pops against the mural here in the reconstruction of what this world would have been like 194 million years ago.
I mean, how must it have been to actually be in a totally different environment than Antarctica today? I mean, it's just stunning that this was, you know, that there was water,
yep,
as opposed to ice.
Water and no white ice, all green, forested. All kinds of critters running.
Still must have had tough winters.
Yeah, that's the interesting point, right? Is that even though there was no polar ice caps and the climate was warmer, these guys are running around, you know, 3 months of total sunlight in the summer and 3 months of darkness in the winter. And we're just scratching the surface of kind of what that would have meant for their biology and their behavior.